Hello, atmosphere explorers. Let's explore some pictures together. What do you think all of these have in common? All of these very different things contain the same essential element, carbon. Carbon is found in fossil fuels, seashells, rocks, and diamonds, but it's also found inside all living things. Carbon is one of the building blocks of life. Glucose, amino acids, cell membranes, DNA, they all contain carbon. We can also find carbon in our atmosphere. Carbon dioxide is one of the other gases that makes up our atmosphere. In fact, we add a little bit of carbon dioxide to the atmosphere every time we breathe out. Remember that carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas, which means that it traps energy from the sun, keeping it here in Earth's troposphere, making it warm enough for life to survive. Carbon dioxide is essential for life. It's one of the main ingredients that plants use to perform photosynthesis. And just like the water cycle, carbon can change forms, cycling through the atmosphere, biosphere, geosphere, and hydrosphere in a special cycle called the carbon cycle. Let's explore the link between the atmosphere and the biosphere as we dive deeper into the carbon cycle. Let's look at our carbon-containing photos again. I'm starting to notice some patterns. In fact, I think we can sort these pictures into two groups. How would you group them? Pause the video here and sort these pictures. How did you sort these pictures? As I sorted, I noticed that some of these examples were living things, while some were non-living things. One of the most exciting features of carbon is that even though it is an essential molecule inside living organisms, it can also be found in many non-living things as well. Carbon can be found in two main forms, organic and inorganic. Organic carbon is found in living things and their remains, like plants, animals, and fossil fuels. Inorganic carbon, on the other hand, is found in non-living things, like carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, seashells, soil, and carbonate rocks. Carbon dioxide can get a bad reputation because we often hear about it when we talk about the human-enhanced greenhouse effect. Extra carbon dioxide in the atmosphere can be harmful, but having carbon in the right balance is essential for life. Remember, carbon is good. Both organic and inorganic carbon are important for supporting life on Earth. The major places we find carbon are called carbon reservoirs. These include the atmosphere, oceans, living things like plants and vegetation, and rocks, soil, and fossil fuels in the ground. But how does carbon move between these reservoirs? How does the oxygen we breathe in turn into the carbon dioxide we breathe out? And does that carbon dioxide just accumulate in the atmosphere? Let's get to the bottom of these questions as we explore the steps of the carbon cycle. Let's think back to the composition of the atmosphere. Carbon dioxide makes up less than 1% of the gases in our atmosphere. Most carbon must be found somewhere else. We'll kick off our journey through the carbon cycle with living things, specifically plants in the biosphere. Carbon dioxide is one of the main ingredients in photosynthesis. Do you remember what happens in photosynthesis? Photosynthesis is the process in which producers, like plants, use energy from the sun to create glucose. In this process, carbon dioxide changes forms from the inorganic atmospheric gas to an organic sugar found inside living things. Plants use this glucose for energy, but so will the herbivores that eat the plants and the predators that eat those herbivores. This step is critical. If plants didn't do photosynthesis, no organisms in the ecosystem would have the energy to survive. So, how do living things turn carbon-containing glucose into usable energy? Glucose sugar is used to make energy in a process known as cellular respiration. Both plants and animals go through this process. As glucose is broken down, guess what is released as a leftover waste product? Carbon dioxide! When you and I breathe out, we're exhaling the carbon dioxide that was left over from our cells performing cellular respiration. We can see that through photosynthesis, food webs, and cellular respiration, carbon cycles quickly between the atmosphere and biosphere reservoirs. Living organisms constantly need more energy to survive, so it's important that these steps in the carbon cycle happen quickly. Not all of the carbon in the biosphere cycles directly back into the atmosphere. Living organisms die, so what happens to all of that carbon in their bodies? When living things die, their bodies undergo the next step in the carbon cycle, decomposition. Some of these organisms are eaten by scavengers or broken down by decomposers, who break down organic carbon and release it back into the atmosphere. But as some of these once-living plants and animals decompose, their remains become trapped in sediment layers that eventually become soil, rocks, or minerals. This is how organic carbon cycles from the biosphere to the geosphere, changing into a form of inorganic carbon. Unlike cycling in the biosphere, this process happens very slowly. Let's take a closer look at how inorganic carbon moves through the carbon cycle. Carbon found in soil, sediment, and rocks in the geosphere is inorganic carbon. Over millions of years, the remains of once-living organisms are buried deeper underground, where high temperature and pressure break them down into coal, oil, and natural gas, forming fossil fuels. Humans mine or drill to access these fuels for transportation, heating, and electricity production. Carbon can cycle from the geosphere back to the atmosphere through a process called combustion. Combustion is simply burning something like fossil fuels. What do you notice happening that could impact the atmosphere? Pause the video and record your observations. As fossil fuels are burned to create electricity, some carbon dioxide gas is released back into the atmosphere. This process also happens naturally when volcanoes erupt. Our final major carbon reservoir is in the hydrosphere. Oceans play a big role in regulating the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. In fact, oceans can hold up to 50 times more carbon than the atmosphere. When carbon dioxide levels in the atmosphere start to increase, the ocean absorbs this gas in a process called ocean uptake. Diffused carbon in the ocean is continually exchanged between the ocean's surface waters and the atmosphere, but some carbon in the deepest parts of the ocean is stored for centuries. This is why oceans are sometimes called carbon sinks. They're great at storing this essential nutrient and regulating the balance of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Just like the water cycle, this cycle doesn't move in only one direction. Carbon can cycle through different forms at different times. It moves quickly through the biosphere and slowly through the geosphere. And it sometimes sits in the atmosphere and hydrosphere for a long time. We just walked through one possible pathway today, But this multi-directional and essential cycle doesn't follow one specific path. Another important thing to keep in mind is that the carbon cycle is a closed cycle. The amount of carbon in the cycle doesn't change, even as the carbon changes forms. Human activities can't add brand new carbon to this cycle, but we can take stored carbon and release it into the atmosphere, throwing off its overall balance. Our breathing out is a normal, balanced part of this cycle. But when humans burn too many fossil fuels or destroy carbon sinks like oceans, forests, or soil through land use, we can add extra carbon dioxide into the atmosphere as we use up the stored fossil fuels, throwing off the balance of this cycle and enhancing the greenhouse effect. More carbon dioxide in the atmosphere can warm temperatures, impact atmospheric circulation, and lead to climate change. But this carbon doesn't just sit in the atmosphere. It also moves through the carbon cycle, impacting the biosphere, hydrosphere, and geosphere too. Can you predict how carbon dioxide in the atmosphere impacts the other spheres? Pause here and record your thoughts. If carbon dioxide increases in the atmosphere, it impacts photosynthesis in plants, which can then impact other organisms in the food web. Warming temperatures in the atmosphere also change habitats, impacting the biosphere. Additionally, the ocean will begin to store more of the atmospheric carbon dioxide. This extra absorption can change the acidity of ocean waters, impacting marine life. These are just some examples of how humans can impact the environment through the carbon cycle. The steps of the carbon cycle are all interconnected, and changing the balance in one sphere can cascade into the other spheres as well. Whew, we covered a lot today. But don't get overwhelmed by all of the steps in the carbon cycle. Let's focus on the big picture. During this cycle, atmospheric carbon dioxide can change forms and move through the atmosphere, biosphere, geosphere, and hydrosphere. These steps can happen in any order, and we just explored one path. In environmental science, all of the spheres are related, so changing the balance in one area can have a big impact. Next time, we'll investigate another cycle that moves from the atmosphere to the biosphere, the nitrogen cycle. Until next time, remember, understanding how carbon cycles through different parts of our planet helps us see the big picture and how our actions can make a difference. Keep exploring and stay curious. Hey, hey.